Okay, good morning, colleagues. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to our first committee meeting of 2016. Can I just remind all members to either switch their phones off or put them into a mode which certainly I can't hear and won't interfere with the processes. Tavish will join us. I think he'll be about 30 minutes late. He's got an important constituency meeting this morning. That's Tavish Scott. First of all, I need to just probably just ask anyone if they have any relevant interests they want to declare this morning, particularly issues around trade union membership, etc. Because it's obviously we're into the trade union bill, so it might be appropriate if anybody has a... Malcolm?
I'm a member of the EIS.
Okay.
I'm a member of the resistance.
Okay.
I'm a long-standing member of the GMB.
Okay. Just make sure we do everything properly. And Happy New Year to you all. Agenda item one seeks the agreement of members of the committee to take a draft report on the UK's trade union bill in private at future meetings of the committee. Can I ask members if they agree that? Yes. Members have agreed, thank you very much. Agenda item two involves taking evidence on the UK government's trade union bill, and I very much warmly welcome the witnesses to the meeting this morning. We have with us Councillor Billy Hendrey, who is the Strategic Human Resource Management spokesperson for COSLA, supported by Jane O'Donnell. And we have Shirley Rogers, who is the Director of the Health Workforce in NHS Scotland, and Dave Moxham, who is the Deputy General Secretary of the STUC. For the record, the committee clerks did approach four individuals to provide an employer business perspective to give evidence at meeting. However, they were unable to do so due to prior commitments, but we may receive some evidence in writing from them. So I think we'll just start with a very general question to the three of you, just to get the proceedings underway. I just wondered what your view might be overall of the trade union bill and obviously at a higher level indicate any particular concerns that you have. We'll obviously get into the detail of some of these concerns as we go through the session this morning. And I'd like to just also ask you, what evidence you think exists for bringing forward this bill from the UK government, particularly given that I read in the government's memorandum that since 2007, the number of industrial disputes in Scotland had decreased by 84%. So if, I don't know who'd like to start off. Dave, would you like to begin that?
Yeah, thank you. Thanks very much, Convener. I was going to start with the statistic that you just cited. You'll not be surprised to hear that the view of the STUC is that this is a bill which is designed to fix a problem that doesn't exist with strike levels at historic low across the UK, and as has been pointed out by the Scottish Government, even lower in Scotland itself. We consider this to be an ideological attack on the very basis of trade unionism, which is designed to provide an effective balance in the workplace between the interests of workers and the interests of managers. Now, I could spend an awful lot of time talking about a whole range of the aspects of this bill. I think from a Scottish perspective, our particular concern is with the aspects of the bill which are designed to undermine the capacity of unions to represent their members in the workplace. And I know that we'll go on to talk in particular about facility time. We know that from an array of polling evidence that the primary reason that people join trade unions remains because they require security in the workplace and they want individual representation when they have a problem at work. And a lot of the focus of this bill from the UK government has been on strike thresholds, political levies, and a range of things which are important and which I'm quite happy to address. But fundamentally, this bill affects the capacity of unions to represent their members in the workplace. And we believe that the government calculates that by removing that capacity from unions, they actually undermine every single aspect of trade unionism as an institution. The international evidence is very, very clear that where trade unions exist and where collective bargaining exists in the workplace, countries are more equal. This isn't evidence that is a matter of left-wing dogma. The right-wing agree with that too. The only difference is the left-wing think it's a good idea and the right-wing think that it's a bad idea. So that rebalancing in the workplace obviously has implications for the individual worker, but it also has wide societal impacts, and we believe that that feeds directly into this Parliament and this government's commitment to greater economic equality in Scotland. I'll leave it there just now. I've got plenty to say on any other point in the proceedings.
Okay, thanks. Shirley?
Thank you very much indeed for the opportunity to come and speak a little bit about the circumstances that we find in the NHS in Scotland, as you'll understand, one of the bigger employers. I think for us, the maturity with which partnership working exists within the NHS is already significantly developed and highly sophisticated. We do see industrial relations as an absolute cornerstone to what we do in the NHS. We believe in co-production and we believe in co-producing in a tripartite relationship between government, employers and staff. So partnership working arrangements in the NHS are very well established. Very, very highly regarded. We have independent studies that cite our partnership working arrangements, if I might quote, as partnership in NHS Scotland has matured into the most ambitious and important contemporary innovation in British public sector industrial relations. So it's not me saying that partnership working does well for the NHS in Scotland, it's independent people saying that. And I think, obviously, I would reflect on Dave's comments in terms of unions' rights as representatives of their members and all of that stuff, which is absolutely critical and important. But I think it's also important that in a modern industrial relations platform, we see our trade unions as strategic partners in the design and development of services and in our journey around continuous improvement. One of the anxieties that we have around the facilities time arrangements that are being proposed is that actually that seeks to compartmentalise how we relate with our trade union partners in a way that is, frankly, significantly less mature than that which we've already developed. Others have already commented on the industrial relations platform in terms of industrial action. We've had these partnership arrangements in the NHS for almost 15 years now, and in that time, you can count on the fingers of one hand the times where we've got into industrial disputes simply because we co-produce, we work with partners, we value the contribution of our staff. It's a highly sophisticated workforce in a very sophisticated working environment. We believe that we get better results because we are able to co-produce, and we frankly believe that our partnership working arrangements as they exist within the NHS are already more mature and more sophisticated and better fit for purpose as a result of the actions that we've taken over the last 15 years.
Thank you, Shirley. Billy, would you like to comment?
Yes, sir.
Thank you, Convener. And, I too also would like to thank you for your invitation to give evidence today. From COSLA's point of view, we have had a long established commitment to joint working with trade union colleagues. This commitment extends beyond industrial relations to working in partnership on the delivery of essential and valued public services across Scotland. Local authorities employ over 250,000 people in Scotland, so it's a considerable figure. COSLA leaders are extremely concerned that the changes proposed within the bill are being brought in with no evidence to back up the assertion that it would modernise industrial relations between councils and trade unions. At present, we have a constructive environment where we work very well with our trade union partners to the benefit of all local communities right across Scotland. We're involved in many different forums with them, and to date, COSLA have found these forums to be very helpful in maintaining positive industrial relations. This ensures that services are delivered smoothly to every community, and that's something we would all want to see continued. The UK government, through the bill, would in effect force councils into changing arrangements for check-off and facility time, which work well for both parties at present. And the cost of these arrangements are already covered by direct contributions from the trade unions themselves. Scottish councils are devolved public bodies. and we wish to make it clear that we consider ourselves as local government empowered to make these type of decisions with the trade unions for the benefit of the local communities that we serve. After all, we are elected members and we are held to account for the decisions we make in respect to facility, time and the issue of check-off. Councillor's position, really in summing up, is that the Westminster Government should reconsider this unnecessary and unjustified imposition, which could ultimately lead to more industrial unrest across Scotland. That's our fear through this progressing of the bill as it stands at the moment.
Thank you, Billy. You touched quite rightly on facility time issues, and I think I'll go to Malcolm Chisholm to lead the discussion in that area. Malcolm.
Well, thanks very much, Bruce, and thanks for your opening contributions. I agree with all that has been said, particularly, I suppose, the NHS angle, given my involvement in that at the start. But I suppose on facilities time, Dave Moxon's already touched on this, but it would be useful to get on the record the advantages of facility time, not from the point of view of employees, which we take for granted, but from the point of view of employers, and any evidence on that. I believe there is quite a lot, but I think it would be quite useful to establish that in some detail to begin with.
Generally, and yeah. I'll probably stay away from the NHS and local government in view of the other witnesses that you have. The headline figures in relation to the cost, if you like, to the public sector we're talking about now of facility time, people have talked about 80 million across the UK, maybe 100 million pounds, represents a very small proportion of the overall spend on public services. Two pieces of evidence I think are particularly useful. One came from Bayer itself in 2010 and an analysis by the University of Essex, I believe, in 2012, both of which I'm happy to refer to, looked not just at the cost but of the benefits of facility time. And they identified five, I think, areas in which the benefit of facility time could be gauged. These included the lower incidence of dismissals in workplaces where facility time was offered, the lower use of tribunals and an extrajudicial process, the health and safety savings, lower incidence of workplace injury, lower workplace of workplace sickness. And it came to the conclusion that for every pound that is spent on facility time, a spectrum of between £3 and £9 is gained. Now, nobody would expect the NHS to take a view about a particular treatment that they were paying for without looking at the broader impacts of what that meant for health more generally, and we would therefore argue that no one should take a view of the cost of facility time without taking a broader view about what problems that might obviate. So on a very basic level, facility time provides the opportunity for reps to cut off what would otherwise be potentially quite serious problems in the workplace at source and deal with them at a lower management level to the benefit of all. There's also very clear evidence that facility time properly used within a partnership environment can help with changing workplace cultures. I'll refer again to public services in particular. We know that public services are incredibly person-centred. There is no way that you can deliver public services without an effective person-to-person workforce. Now, increasingly, it becomes absolutely vital, therefore, that as cultures change and as government quite rightly looks to introduce public service reform, that the workforce is taken with them on that. And in that respect, facility time and partnership working is absolutely vital to deliver that. The final thing I would say is some of the biggest firms, some of the biggest private sector firms in Scotland fund facility time. They fund facility time because they understand that even in the cutthroat world of profit-making private enterprise out there, that facility time and trade union recognition and collective bargaining can play a vital role in the profitability of their companies.
I wonder if I might add to that with a little bit of detail about how the NHS facility time arrangements work and some thoughts around that. And I'll perhaps start by saying I'm not aware of a truly world-class organisation that thinks it can be world-class without talking to its staff. I think when we're talking about facility time, it is very easy to revert to a position that says that's about trade unions going along to represent somebody at a disciplinary or whatever. I think in facility time sense, we took a view in the NHS some years ago that we wanted to invest in co-production, that we wanted to front load our investment in facility time to allow us to have a better product rather than to spend our time in conflict resolution and dispute management. And the proof of that pudding is that over the last 10, 15 years, we can literally count the number of disputes on one hand. But that's actually one of the blunter, less valuable pieces of evidence as far as I'm concerned. At the same time as we've been wrestling with all of the transformational change that the NHS has undergone, we've produced with our staff side a workforce strategy which is held in very high regard. We've been able to put forward a series of proposals and policies around absence management, employee conduct, disciplinary procedures, you name it, a whole suite of policies which have had a great deal more effectiveness because they haven't been about management designing stuff which is then applied. They've been about something which has been co-produced, something that's been actually able to be delivered. Now, the NHS is a big organisation, not quite the numbers that Councillor Hendrey was quoting, but about 156,000 people. And we recognise that in order for partnership working to be effective within the NHS, we needed to have some structures. We couldn't just hope that people were going to talk to each other. So we have a national partnership forum, a Scottish partnership forum across the NHS, co-chaired and a tripartite relationship between government, employers and staff side. At board level, every board in Scotland has a partnership agreement and every board in Scotland has an employee director. This is somebody whose focus, role and purpose it is to be a representative at board level to make sure that staff views. And remember that, you know, in staff views we're talking about doctors, nurses, dentists, people across the range of professions whose voices we need to hear to be able to design services. Have that voice at board level to be able to influence right from the outset the kind of strategic direction that organisations in the NHS want to take. Some of the boards are much bigger than others. Some, a board such as Glasgow will have a variety of facility time arrangements. Some individuals will be on a full-time basis, others on a part-time basis. Some of the smaller boards have those facility time agreements on a part-time basis with staff doing other duties as well. But what we've found is that universally that means that when the boards are looking to do something, when government is looking to have policy which can actually be implemented and is designed to be effective, we've got measures that are much more able to be implemented and are sponsored not just by somebody like me saying so, but actually by our workforce agreeing and harnessing and putting themselves behind those efforts too.
Billy?
Yes, I was just going to say, I have to remember there are 32 local authorities in Scotland and the umbrella body, COSLA. So you have national and you have local partnerships between the employers and the trade unions. And every council is different. And I have to say that there is nothing broken about this. This is something that's been working for many years now. It's been some time now since there's been a national strike within local government. There will always be some local tensions. That will always happen. But what made that possible, in my opinion, is the forums that I alluded to in my opening remarks, the partnership committees, the formal and informal ways in which the employer and the employee representatives can try and iron out particular problems. I think that is central. And if we're in a position where that is being reduced, diminished in any way, what we'll see is that opportunity to talk, to, in some cases, argue things out, but at the very least, the time there affords us all an opportunity to have a say and do the best thing, ultimately, for the communities that we serve. So what I said at the beginning in my opening remarks is that this is working at present for us in local government, so we really don't see the point in changing it in any way. And from an umbrella local government point of view, Councillor very much agrees and promotes with localism. And again, that's the type of thing that's been promoted by the existing structures. Every single council having a partnership agreement, forum set up to fit their particular needs, their geographical areas, etc., etc. So facility time has to be preserved, in my view, or we will be facing a situation where there could be problems further down the road with potential industrial action.
It seems clear to me, I think, that this is quite a significant interference with areas of devolved policy and priorities. And although we're not here to consider legislative consent issues specifically, I do wonder if Dave Moxham would like to comment, because I think you believe this is one of two areas where there is such a significant interference with devolved competence that you think legislative consent should be sought.
We do. I suppose I start from, and I know there's a potential question at some stage about the level of consultation that's been undertaken by the Westminster government. But when we had our first meeting with Westminster officials in relation to this bill, and it was actually just before they announced the provisions with respect to check-off, but the facility time provisions were already there. We raised with them the issue of the devolved competency. They hadn't even considered it at that point. It was one of those meetings where lots of scribbling takes place and lots of quizzical eyebrows are raised. So at the point, and we're talking, you know, well, more than 8 weeks into the past the first reading of the bill, this hadn't been considered. So this isn't a question, in our view, of Westminster having considered this and been ready for it. It dropped into their laps because they hadn't thought about it at all. So that's the starting point. One of the questions we put to bear at the time, and we continue to put to Westminster, is why is this provision on facility time only in reference to the public sector? Why isn't it in reference to the private sector? If there was some ideological or political or administrative objection to facility time, why would this not apply to all employers across the whole of the United Kingdom? Now, the response that's come back to us is very clear. It's because the UK government considers its role to safeguard public money. Now, our question to them comes straight back. Well, it's not this part of public money isn't yours to safeguard. It's the Scottish Parliament's to safeguard, of its Councillors, of its the NHS. So for us to start with, there's a fundamental problem, which is if the basis of the facility time regulations is the protection of public money, then that fails the test of devolution in Scotland. When it comes to legislative consent in particular, and we recognise that this is a complicated area, we certainly recognise that we're in a situation which I think is unprecedented in relation to the UK government not having taken the view that legislative consent might be required and it being generated, if you like, from the Scottish Parliament itself. We really are unsure of the view that this does not affect the administrative competence of the Scottish Parliament, and the defence that this is relating to an entirely reserved bill, Tulkra, we don't believe stands up either. It seems to us self-evident that amendment could be made to a UK Act, an entirely reserved Act, that had implications for the competence or the administrative competence of the Scottish Parliament, and that would be a matter for this Parliament. So for a number of reasons, we were disappointed, to be frank, that the presiding officer took the view that she did, and we're very hopeful that that a suitable mechanism will be found within the Parliament to allow this Parliament to bring forward an LCM.
Okay, thank you.
Now, we're going to go, Rob.
Point. May I try to bottom out what the actual costs and savings are? Mm-hmm. The UK minister suggested that there could be a saving of £150 million a year by reducing the spending on facility time. Could I put it in two ways? Shirley Rogers talked about having a more mature system already with co-production and partnership. And the point is, can we quantify what that helps the NHS and local government to function more effectively? Can we counter this argument that reducing facility time will save money?
I mean, obviously, I mean, the quantification, it's not an easy science because how do you estimate the value of a better running NHS? In a sense, you have to take the evidence of the experts, one of whom is sitting next to me. So we do have the report that I referred to, which was a UK-wide report, which looked very specifically at savings relating to a whole range of better employment, health, and other outcomes. But of course, that leaves aside, I think as you imply, that leaves aside how you quantify the effect of a better operating organisation. The NHS, by and large, doesn't have anybody to compete with, so it doesn't have a set of figures that it can put alongside a similar private sector organisation to say, hey, we do better on this basis. So we have to, at the end of the day, we have to trust the professionals, but these are professionals, whether in local government or NHS. They don't have money to throw around. These aren't people who are currently not under budgetary constraints. If they believed that this was a waste of money, I believe that they would be taking a very clear view on that basis.
Tell me what they think about that before we come back to Rob.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Sure.
If I might respond to Mr. Gibson, it's very difficult to refute £150 million because I'm not sure that I've seen the evidence that constructs £150 million. It's also very difficult to quantify how you do business. So at a granular level, I can say that good representation, which prevents somebody going to an industrial tribunal, might potentially save several thousand pounds. At a more strategic level, I can say that if we're serious about bringing forward a public services reform agenda, and a journey of continuous improvement, it seems to me to be inconceivable that the NHS in Scotland would wish to do so without some kind of opportunity to talk to the doctors, nurses, radiotherapists and all sorts of other professions who contribute to delivering that service. So change is not easy anyway. Change without talking to people, one, becomes very high risk, and two, is highly unlikely for me to be sitting here as a successful workforce director in a couple of years' time, I suspect. So I could, as I've indicated earlier on, look to various boards who can identify how much they spend in terms of individuals who have facility time. But I think it is, if I may say, an unfair reflection of the mature system that we have if we think that the value of somebody is the amount of hours and the pounds, shillings and pence that is spent on them being in that particular room. So my difficulty with the facilities time thing is not about cost. Boards are already in a position where they see that as an investment, actually, and those investments have already been made. My issue about facility time is about if we are honest and have integrity in our view that we are looking for proper, mature engagement with our workforce, it seems to me to be somewhat retrograde to then say, and we're going to give you 27 minutes and we'll have another process if it's going to take 28.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, I was just going to add and say that, just following on from Dave's point, if this was something that was a waste of money, and my own council needs to balance, I've got absolutely no doubt that there will be councillors within that authority, and I'm sure right across Scotland, who would be putting down amendments, motions, whatever, to try and prevent this. That opportunity is already there. But I know that it's generally believed right across the political spectrum in Scotland that within local government that we actually see the benefits. Now, when it comes to actually quantifying that financially, well, that's difficult. Yes, if we save money not going to an industrial tribunal, yes, you could put something to that, but that would be a very, very extensive exercise. But from my point of view, where I see the benefit for everyone is the continuity of service delivery. That's the important thing. If there are no strikes, the man and woman within each authority are getting the services that they pay for and the services they need and the services that they deserve. And another area, if I could touch on this slightly, in relation to the work that we do in COSLA, we work very, very closely on the SJC, in particular, on new initiatives. And one of the things that we're doing just now is that we're looking at developing the wellbeing theme across local government. And what that means is, health and wellbeing, I should say, what that means is, in all areas of the public sector, and then there's fairly high levels of absenteeism. And what we want to do is we want to reduce that. Not about in any way with bringing out draconian measures or anything like that, but working with trade unions to see how we can make it better for people to be at work and stay at work. And obviously, that takes pressure off the public person. It also helps co-workers. So again, quantifying it, difficult, but if we get more people in work, staying in work, and delivering services, well, that's something I think certainly we should be content to promote.
Duncan, I think one supplementary here.
Yeah. Quickly, gives me a chance to put my trade union credentials on the on the table. As a trade union member for nearly 50 years, 25 of those years as a shop steward, the shop steward's convener, and a full time official. I think I'm trying to pick up on Shirley's explanation here about our reference to what it was like 30 years ago as a young steward to that dispute resolution, and the time and involvement that multiplied by, you know, any amount of number right across the health service, to a more satisfying involvement and partnership and support and change. And I did that not just in the public sector, but I did it in one of Scotland's most successful private enterprises, which is the whisky industry. Classic example of that. But to get to the question about how, you know, we know that it was a very, very difficult journey to build the trust, to be able to create change, and to create a status of partnership where ongoing change can be agreed in a very constructive way. How quickly does that trust go? How quickly do you believe that what we now have in place would fall into disrepute and we would be slowly slipping back into a situation where we're resolving disputes and arguments every other day, which take up managerial time, stop progress and change, delay projects? How quickly do we lose what we've gained over hard won gains over the last 25 years or so?
Shirley, can I ask you to start off with that?
Thank you. You're absolutely right. I mean, trust is something that's hard won and easy lost. And if I refer back to my opening comments about the fact that partnership exists within the NHS on the basis of a tripartite relationship, that only works if those three parties are mutually respectful and have a sense of the importance of each other. So if it becomes the case that we revert back to, can I have 10 minutes off to go to a meeting about X, that shades the conversation considerably about how people can contribute. If I think back to the last couple of years, any potential for dispute that has happened within the NHS in Scotland has been resolved by a reversion back to our partnership values and about how we behave. So again, coming back almost to Mr. Gibson's question about quantification, how do you quantify the cost of not having a dispute in that way? But trust, for me, is absolutely critical. When I referred earlier on to our workforce strategy, when we were co-producing that with, in the first year, over 10,000 NHS workers in Scotland who contributed to the development of that strategy. It's now 3 years old. I suspect the number of that has doubled. What they said to us was that the values of the NHS, about respect, about care, compassion, the stuff that is the founding principles of our partnership working arrangements, were absolutely fundamental, not just to the delivery of health services as they are now, but also as we address some of the challenges that Billy was referring to earlier on about health and social care and future services and all that kind of stuff. At the moment, we have a very honest and trusting relationship. I speak regularly to trade union officials. I speak regularly to STUC officials. They speak regularly to me. There isn't a day that goes by that we don't have conversations, some of which are strategic, some of which are very practical about how we resolve particular bits of issues. Our ability to be able to promote change is fundamentally dependent upon those relationships of trust. And anything that diverts us from that, this is not a good time to be diverted from that, even if we thought it was a good idea.
Is that substantial enough in what Shirley's given us, or is it, does any other gentleman want to add to that? Okay. In which case, I'll go to Stuart McMillan first on the consultation matter, and then I want to come to Alec Johnson after that, and in regard to the wider, some wider issues. Okay. Stuart, because I think it was Dave who touched on the consultation issue, which they had certainly had with. And if you don't mind, Dave, at this stage before bringing Stuart in, you mentioned BEAR, but could you, which is the government organisation, you just put on record what that is, its longer title is, please.
I'll need you to remember it now.
That's what I was sorry, I was
business,
so I thought you
business enterprise and regulation.
Regulated from, thank you, because I couldn't remember, so I had to ask you. Stuart.
Thanks, Convener. But also, Dave, you did touch upon the consultation, the meeting you had down at Westminster. But in terms of the other panellists, have you been involved in the consultation process with either the UK government and also the Scottish government?
Only as a representative of SG, as an official of SG, in terms of my role in health workforce.
Decided that we'd be taking up a lobbying role and we'll be dealing with them via letter.
Okay. Do you think that the consultation process up to now has actually been adequate?
As I indicated earlier, I don't. There's a couple of examples of that. I mean, the tried and tested, in our view, mechanism of introducing a first reading just before before a summer recess, which was what happened, and then a fairly swift second, third reading and Commons phase, which for us normally presages an attempt to rush through a bill. The reference I made earlier to the non-preparedness, frankly, of government departments in terms of the one visit that they did make to Scotland to speak with us. A lack of recognition, I think, of the current devolved powers of the Scottish Parliament. Now, one can take a view, and people are welcome to take the view they want about the specific competence of aspects of this bill. But what is absolutely clear is that the Scottish Government has key enterprise and economic functions. It has key functions as an employer itself, and it has, you know, key strategic interests in a whole range lot of major industries. Now, what that suggested to us, at the very least, was that the UK government should have been interested, not just in the perspective of the Scottish government itself, the Scottish Parliament and the powers it held, but also to want to talk really quite specifically to some of the leaders of industry in Scotland, delivering some of our key industrial targets. None of that happened. And none of that happened, and we moved very quickly to a committee stage. Anybody who witnessed the committee stage will have noticed that the quality of questioning from the opposition, both Labour and SNP, was very, very high. The quality of engagement of the Tory representatives on that committee was frankly puerile. I mean, they literally did not at any stage put any serious scrutiny in relation to the bill itself. So we have a failure to consult, a very rushed process, a committee stage which, in our view, was very, very poor. And along that process, the introduction of a couple of key additional aspects of the bill. So we didn't know until well after the first reading about the introduction of the check-off arrangements. That wasn't subject to any consultation, and it wasn't subject to any assessment of the cost. So we essentially have a piece of legislation which is now past its common stage, which asserts that there is a large cost to the public sector of check-off, which is clearly and utterly not substantiated by any evidence. That adds up to us to a very, very poor process of consultation.
If I may, I think others are perhaps better placed than I am to comment on the politicking of that. I think the observation that I would make is that we continue to look for the evidence that supports these initiatives. So that concerns me. And I suppose in the absence of having the full evidence to support that, our role seems now to be much more constrained than I would wish it to in having to think about the impact of it. So I think others are better placed than I am to comment on the legislative and political framework for it. But it goes back to the question that Mr. Gibson asked about cost. In the absence of an evidential platform that I can use to make those assessments, it's difficult for us to comment on whether or not the end justifies the means in that sense. We're now, I think, more concerned with trying to make sure that we understand the impact potentially.
Just very briefly, time scales are undoubtedly very, very tight. And in answer to your question about consultation, I think Cosloe's position is that it would have been helpful if there was more time for us to engage in the process. But we are where we are at the moment, and we must press ahead with our opposition to the various parts that we've been discussing today.
So, Mr. Moxham, you mentioned there in terms of the lack of dialogue with Scotland on this. In terms of your own opinion on this, do you think that's maybe down to the folk in the UK government maybe either not fully appreciating the powers that the Scottish Parliament actually has, or do you think it's whether it was actually at the political level or at the civil servant level, or do you think there's maybe something else that was actually at play at that particular time?
I'm tempted to say that because of that one meeting that I cited earlier with officials, that it just didn't occur to them, which in a sense is worse than if it did occur to them in many ways. But we have, through a series of questions and through the action of particularly Chris Stevens, MP, who is the SNP lead, or was the SNP lead, on the bill committee, we have attempted to scrutinise, and to ask a number of questions which would identify whether this is a problem that the government anticipated and chose to ignore or not. For instance, and again, I can cite the cite the letter as evidence. A letter from Chris Stevens to Nick Bowles, the responsible minister at Westminster, which asked how they foresaw the application of the regulations in relation to facility time and how it would potentially affect an organisation like NHS Scotland, because it wasn't clear to us how they saw it working. Now, what that letter essentially indicates, and I think there was an aspect of thinking on their feet here, was that the minister in charge of the NHS in England will essentially be responsible for dictating the facility time arrangement and implementing the aspects of the bill as they relate to the NHS in Scotland. You know, that's almost worth repeating, because there's more than one way that you could deal with that situation. You could deal with that in a number of ways. But the way they seem to have chosen, and as I say, Nick Bowles has put this in writing, is the Minister for the English NHS will be empowered under this bill, so it seems, to be able to take the decision that the NHS in Scotland's facility time is too great and therefore should be cut. Now, that seems to us to clearly not be something that they thought about in July or August of this year, and something that they've come to because they simply hadn't considered the implications of what they were doing.
To that specific point, because I know Linda Fabiani is particularly interested in it, but I need to go to Alec Johnston now to pick up an opportunity to get in.
Thank you very much, Convener. We've covered a few of the issues I was going to raise, but there's been a couple of issues for clarification that would be very useful. Now, I'm a good old-fashioned Tory whose opinions in the trade union movement were formed in the 1970s, and I'm fully aware that things have changed radically since then. And one of the things I wanted to clarify, and Dave Moxham has touched on this a couple of times, is the distribution of trade union membership. Now, it used to be rooted in the industrial base, but it has changed radically over time. And my impression is that when we talk about trade unionism in Scotland, we're essentially talking about something that manifests itself primarily, if not exclusively, within public services. Is that a fair assumption to make?
It's not. It's quite true to say that the proportion of trade union members per capita is far higher in the public sector. We estimate 55 to 60%, and it's significantly lower in the private sector. However, nearly as many members in Scotland are private sector employees as public sector employees, because obviously the private sector is three times the size of the public sector. More than half of the private sector companies in Scotland, the largest private sector companies quoted on the stock exchange, are unionised, have trade union recognition, and obviously offer facility time, and in many cases check off to their employees. So sometimes we make the mistake of looking at the proportions rather than the absolute numbers. Nearly as many people in Scotland in the private sector are trade union members as in the public sector.
We talked earlier about the way that this would apply to public services and to those who are outside the public service sector. In that respect, taking that into account, do you feel that we're talking about something here that needs to be addressed in the broadest possible sense, or is it disproportionately important to talk about the effects in the public services?
No, I mean, the reason that we've talked most specifically about the public services here and possibly in relation to the bill generally is because the UK government has chosen some provisions which will apply to the public sector but won't apply to the private sector. So they're essentially, in our view, differentiating between the rights of public sector employees to negotiate with their employer the right to check off, the right to facility time, and private sector employees. So in a sense, it's the government's choice. It's the UK government's choice that we end up talking more about the public sector because they've chose to differentiate between those rights to treat public sector employers differently to private sector employers. Now, I think it's important. We would recognise that one of the aims of the Westminster government, I may be anticipating a question that you would ask, is to recognise that the effect of industrial action in the public sector can be argued to be somewhat different in many cases than the effects in the private sector. There is not, if you like, an employer's profitability. There is not a, you know, there is not a profit margin to be affected. The main effect is in terms of the service that is provided. That's one of the reasons that public sector strikes are so low, because public sector workers don't actually like doing that very much. But at the end of the day, the basic rights of a public sector employee should be the same as the basic rights of a private sector employee.
Mm. I think we've got the information I needed there, but it occurs to me that in his opening remarks, the convener commented on the fact that there were other people invited to come along here today and were unavailable for whatever reason. Do you think, given the spread of impact, that it is necessary for us to perhaps work a bit harder to get a broader input and evidence on this subject?
To be frank, whether at a Westminster level or here today, it's been very difficult for either Parliament to garner very much enthusiasm from business organisations for this legislation. A number of the organisations that were listed initially on the Westminster evidence list, frankly, just didn't trap. We feel that, you know, a number of the business organisations have had to be squeezed quite hard to say very much about this. And this is because organisations like the CBI are on record just two or three years ago, positively welcoming the role of trade unions in the workplace and welcoming facility time and these things. Frankly, the business organisations and most of the major private sector employers hadn't identified a problem. And I think it's going to be quite difficult for you, frankly, to get a range of business organisations to sit here and robustly defend this bill, because I don't think they're very enthusiastic about it at all.
So, finally, then, should we...
Can I just like Shirley to respond to that point? Like, I think she wanted to respond to it as well.
My career has operated in both the private and the public sector. And I think the dynamic that I will have observed over the last 30 years is that if we can agree that we've moved away from the industrial age, then I would certainly contend that we are now firmly in the age of engagement, and that workforce expect to be engaged with their employer. They expect to have a relationship with their employer which is very different from that which we might have typified 30 or 40 years ago. So I take your point that the evidence that is being presented here is obviously by two of the biggest employers in Scotland in sheer volume terms, but I think looking more widely across my industry as a sort of professional workforce industry, if we can call it that way, the issues about how we make sure that our employees are engaged with are universal.
Just finally, the nature of what's happening makes this essentially a public sector issue. Should we as a committee be content to treat it as such, or should we be trying to broaden it out?
I think that's a matter for the committee, to be frank.
One other objection, I suppose, there's cross-fertilisation here. So, you know, you've mentioned, Shirley, you worked in the private sector and the public sector. Trade unions work in the private sector and the public sector. And good practice is a benefit to all. If you create that, if you can create change in a major industry like whiskey by using partnership, some of the benefits that come out of that are picked up by others. Good practice is developed, and if that's not allowed to happen here, turn into a witness maybe, then it can damage industrial relations across the board.
Yeah, listen, we're
prolonging. If I may just make one observation in light of what Mr. McNeill has just said. We were all of us, I think, certainly my team were engaged with the Working Together Review, which was precisely that. It was looking to adopt good practice in industrial relations across public and private sector to find a model that was fit for Scotland.
With that, I'll go to Mark.
Thank you, Convener. I'm struck listening to the arguments that are being put in relation to the decision by the UK government to focus on the public sector rather than across the piece. And Dave, I think, highlighted the notion that the government views themselves as having a responsibility for how public money is spent. I'd always assumed that the government also had a responsibility to how the wider economy functions, and given that we've just come through a period where industrial action was narrowly avoided in the offshore sector, one would have assumed that, you know, the impact that that could have potentially had on the public finances would have perhaps led the government to take a wider view. So I think that clearly to me demonstrates the ideological nature of this rather than it being simply about protection of public money. But what I wanted to ask was around the ballot thresholds, which obviously is looking to be changed. And I know we've heard the argument rehearsed, and it's one that I have some sympathy with around politicians who've been elected on very low turnouts, claiming that they have some kind of authority to tell unions about turnout levels. But I wonder, in terms of the impact that that could have in terms of industrial relations, if thresholds are altered in that respect.
Yeah, I mean, I'd make one very general comment, and it won't be about turnout in elections. You'll be glad to know. It's fundamentally wrong that an abstention should be counted as a no vote. That's just, you know, that's just democratically wrong. What the threshold proposals do is they misunderstand the process that unions essentially go through when it comes to reaching a point of potential industrial action. In the public sector, for instance, you would expect members to be balloted in the first instance on whether a particular pay deal was, if we're using pay as an example, was acceptable or not. They'd then be balloted, assuming that lots of them said not, on whether they wanted to take industrial action or action short of strike. And if then they decided that they were in favour of industrial action, they would then, as individuals, have the right to take that industrial action or not. So you're essentially talking about a three-part democratic process, one which is very hard for us to run because all of that is done by postal ballot. So it's difficult, but it's a three-part process. Now, all the way along that process, being frank, and Duncan will remember this well, as will others, the union is taking a view about how likely that third part, that industrial action, is to be successful or not. So being frank, you will not see many pieces of industrial action out there where 51% of people on a 22% turnout decide that they're going to take a decision is taken to do industrial action, and that's because point three is not going to be effective. If you march your troops up to the top of the hill, being frank with you, you better make sure they don't fall off the top of the hill. So there's a lot of misunderstanding about the breadth of what actually takes place and the judgment that democratically elected officials take when they do that. And along that process at the moment, there's quite a lot of stopping off points. So the stopping off points are where you say, okay, the action, you know, the views aren't as strong as we thought, or, you know, management are coming back with a deal. We have a period of time in which we can take these judgments. And what the government is doing through thresholds, through its changes to ballot notice periods, through its whole changes, is essentially making that situation more a sharper one for unions. So unions will have to take decisions probably quicker potentially on a more aggressive basis as to whether to move into industrial action or not. So the real risk of all of that is not that industrial action is less, but that industrial action is more, because the process is one which is harder for unions to navigate without recourse to industrial action in the final analysis.
Do either of the other ministers want to offer anything on? And I guess the follow-on point from that, and there'd been an allusion from all of you to the difficulties that could be created in industrial relations were this legislation to go through. Are you able to quantify that in any way in terms of, you know, what we could be looking at if this legislation goes through in terms of the difficulties that are going to be created?
Again, that's difficult because you haven't really got a point of comparison. All I can say is that on a very regular basis, following a process in which an industrial action ballot has taken place, that industrial action does not happen because there is a process and a time period in place whereby management and union can get back round the table and have that discussion, and industrial action is averted. So industrial action is averted far more frequently than it actually takes place, even after an industrial ballot is successful.
Do you think then that there's the potential that that incentive, if you will, for management to get round the table again and discuss could be diminished, were they to view it that, well, they're not going to get the turnout on this ballot that would meet that threshold?
I think there's a risk that incentives for both sides of an industrial, around a potential industrial dispute, are reduced because the window of opportunity for resolving that dispute through further discussion will be less.
Shirley, I don't know if you wanted to comment on that.
I think it's very difficult to quantify that because the way that I've described partnership working in the NHS is now a long-established practice. So I think people are used to resolving difficulties through conversation and through dialogue. But I think the natural inclination of managers and staff side within the health context, I would hope, and I'm fairly confident, would be that they would continue to try and seek those opportunities for dialogue.
Okay. 30 minutes left, folks. I need to make sure we're quite focused. I've still got to get check-off issues in and regulation issues in. But Alison, you want to follow up in this area as well?
Yes, please. Thanks, Convener. It seems to me, as a committee, we've been scrutinising further powers, and one of the things we've been looking at really closely is intergovernmental relations, because one of the impacts of increased devolved powers is that we're going to have to work more collaboratively with Westminster. But here we have an instance where there seems to be a real impact on our current devolved powers. And really, I suppose at the heart of this is what happens to workers' basic rights. That is a concern that I have, because this legislation is wide enough to affect the terms of employment of those who are working in our public authorities and in our local authorities. I mean, the issue that my colleague Mark MacDonald raised there is a case in point. And I just wonder what concerns you have about that. I mean, we really are having a tremendously, potentially negative impact on relationships at all sorts of levels with this bill. Is there anything, I mean, the Scottish Government, we're obviously the Scottish Parliament is seeking to ensure that this legislation doesn't impact on Scotland, but what are your concerns, you know, at that workers' level that it might have?
I think it's probably important, I haven't mentioned this yet, it's important to point out, just in case anybody's under any doubt, that nothing in current legislation compels Shirley or anybody else to provide facility time for employees or check-off. So we're essentially talking about the relationship between individuals and their representatives and employers on a workplace-by-workplace basis. Now, our view is that that should essentially be a contractual matter. Obviously, there are a range of regulations in place for where that happens and how it might happen, but it's essentially, at the end of the day, it should be a contractual matter between the individual and their representative and their employer. So when we talk about government relations here, we're not talking about the Westminster government somehow fleeing the NHS in Scotland for something that they're forced to do. It's about preventing them from doing something that they currently choose to do. Now, I think that within the current devolved context, that should be approached with far more caution than the other example. So it impacts upon the individual because it says we are taking away not a duty that the NHS has, but a right that you have to request a contractual relationship with your employer that if your employer chooses to agree to, you may have. And we're going to tell the Scottish Government that it is forced to implement that. Now, it seems to me that that is a pretty poor state of affairs, particularly for a government that says that it's committed to aspects such as localism and employer choice. So I know I'm probably talking more specifically about your your government relation aspect of that, but I think it does impact upon the individual because essentially it removes a right that the individual currently enjoys.
I think Dave summed that very nicely. We have chosen to make that investment because we believe that that has worked for us. The only other point, if I make very briefly, Chairman, is that I'm concerned about the view that industrial relations are a continual steady state, which has not been my experience. So for ministers to, for example, prescribe facility time, do they do that on a normal Monday when everybody loves each other, or do they do that on a day when we've got a significant change agenda or indeed a dispute? These are things which are by their nature flexible because there are times when we spend more time fixing something or developing something than others. So the only addition I would make to the comments that Dave's made is that the reason that we've chosen to do partnership working in the NHS in the manner in which we have is that we found it to be extremely beneficial and to have the flexibilities that reflect the NHS where there are daily occurrences that require discussions with staff.
I don't really think I've got anything to add what Shirley said there.
Yeah, so I mean, it's fair to say that you think the impacts on local and public authorities haven't been fully considered.
I think they haven't been fully considered, and I think that it's properly a matter for local authorities and devolved employers to make that consideration.
Okay, I'm going to move on to Stuart Maxwell now, but I think from that conversation I've just heard, actually, I think what we just said is if this system didn't exist in the public sector in the way it does, another private sector organisations to improve industrial relations would go about creating this sort of architecture to make it happen, to make sure things were proceeding in an appropriate way. That's a comment rather than a question. Stuart Maxwell, because yes, I've not said anything for a while. Stuart Maxwell.
and I was missing your words of wisdom. Thank you for that. But I was going to ask about, I think you just answered it in response to Alison, about given it's not compulsory to do check-off, you know, by any employer, effectively, you know, you choose to do it because in any analysis of the benefits and the disbenefits of such a move, you have chosen that this is more beneficial than it is disbeneficial to your organisations. However, can I move on slightly, given that you've sort of answered that, I think, in relation to Alison's questions. I mean, are there, you know, taking it from the UK government's point of view, are there any particular benefits that you can see in a reduction in costs or any other benefits that may arise from the removal, well, it's not the removal, the ban on check-off?
If I might start from that perspective, I think it would be foolish for us to proceed with the notion that NHS pay is a number which is spat out once a month, and check-off is the only variable that is requiring this vast amount of time to go in and do. NHS pay is covers from portering staff to senior consultants, covers those staff who work full-time, part-time, who have varying allowances, who work on call, who work in variable shift patterns, who have particular allowances for public holidays, particular allowances for non-public holidays and all sorts of other things, everything from shift working premiums to distinction awards. So if there is a sense that check-off means that pay that doesn't have any attention in central payroll at the moment will become massively simplified and therefore reduce a significant cost burden, I think that is a misguided premise. NHS pay is a complex thing. It runs well through, thankfully, through good computer-based systems. I'm not aware of any part of the system identifying check-off as a significant burden to that payroll cost.
Yeah, in respect to local government, all councils, there are many different types of deductions from salary. It could be in relation to childcare, initiatives for people buying bicycles to get to work,
you name it, it causes us absolutely no problem whatsoever, and it has no financial bearing at all in any way. It's something that we've done, we've have no issues with. Payroll, I've never flagged up any problems as far as I'm aware, so to change it, in my view, again, is unnecessary.
Well, I mean, Billy's actually led on to my second question, which is on, given that the ban is on purely on check-off, but not on removal of charitable donations, loans, or any other things that you do through your payroll system, you know, can you come to any other conclusion this is entirely ideologically driven, given that no other facility from payroll is being affected by this?
It's probably not for me to comment on ideology.
Well,
of
perhaps
it.
It's maybe David.
But perhaps what I could say is that check-off is, by its nature, something which is entered into on an individual arrangement over a period of time. So people who've been members of trade unions have probably been members of trade unions for some time and don't do that on a once-only, never-to-be-repeated special offer basis. So whilst there is no significant cost to us in running check-off through payroll now, there may be a cost of having to remove all of that information at any given point. So the NHS has a workforce that has, you know, up to 40 years service, not as an exception. Those arrangements have built up over time. If it was required that all of those check-off arrangements were removed at any one point in time, that would potentially have a cost to the system.
You'll guess my conclusion, but if there was going to be one form of payment that one might argue was legitimately made through the payroll, it would be the payment that was most allied to your status. You work and you choose or not choose to pay your dues to a union, which are directly related to that employment. When the employment ceases, you may well choose. You certainly won't be paying through your payroll anymore, but you might choose. There is no other payment. One might argue pensions. There is no other deduction that is so intrinsically linked to the fact that you work and that you get that wage. So if there was going to be one single payment that you wouldn't touch, and I'm perfectly in favour of payroll deduction for all of the things it's currently used for, then that's the one that you would protect. Why is it happening in the public sector just, even though, I mean, the evidence is quite clear that, number one, it isn't, in most cases, any, or in most cases, any meaningful cost to the public sector, but not in the private sector, I think tells the story that it's ideological. In a sense, you wonder why would the Westminster government not want to do that to the private sector too? And I think that the ideology of not interfering with the private sector is kind of bigger than the ideology of wanting to make things more difficult for trade union members. I mean, what's behind this? Because obviously, there's some significant sections of the public sector, teachers, for instance, who collect dues through direct debit, and many unions are quite open to the idea over a period of time, as long as the member wants it and as long as it's suitable to everyone, to moving across to direct debit payments. What's behind this is that a window will be provided. So when this legislation passes, there will be a 3-month or a 4-month or a 6-month window given, in which the union will be required to transfer everybody from payroll deduction to direct debit. Now, that's just a hard job to do. What it requires is going in and meeting and speaking in a whole range of diverse workplaces to every single person and getting their signature. Now, the government has evidence, because it already did this through areas of the civil service in the last couple of years. It has evidence that that's really, really difficult, that unions are forced to devote all of their resources to doing that, and that even then, as with any system where you're changing from one system to another, you get friction and you lose people. So it's an attack on the individual members' right to have their dues paid in the most simple way and straightforward way that they choose, but it's also an attack on trade union capacity and attack on trade union finances too, because they know that however hard we work, we won't hit 100%.
Of it.
I think if you change it, no doubt, common sense, that's going to create more work and cost. But in relation to cost, I think it's worth pointing out that trade unions make a contribution to this. That varies across Scotland, and it comes back to the localism issue. Different areas, there's different partnership agreements, and there are different contributions. So it is cost neutral, as far as I'm aware. It's not costing us anything at all. And my fear is that local government is experiencing a very difficult time financially. Any burden is a burden too much, and changing payroll systems is something that I wouldn't like to see, and I think most people associated with local government would not like to see a change in that. To me, I just don't see the point in it.
One wee point, then I must go to London.
I understand. Final question. I just want specifically to Dave on this question about how would you deal with the situation where if check-offs abolished and effectively you have somebody playing by direct debit, how would you know that they move from one particular area of work to another area of work in terms of holding a ballot or any other way that you organise within a workforce, for example? You know, if you've got a large workforce and dispersed sites, effectively there could be a dispute in one but not in another. If somebody's paying you by direct debit rather than through check-off, does that not create difficulties for unions in terms of trying to organise who indeed would be able to vote or not vote in a ballot, for example?
It's difficult already. I mean, there's already fairly rigorous rules in place through the certification office, which requires unions to keep up to date with not just the place of work in a diverse workplace, but also addresses and various other things. Because remember, because we have to do postal ballot, we have to be in a position where if members are balloted on something, that they get they get the postal ballot. So it's already really quite difficult and quite time consuming to do that. This will make it somewhat more difficult. I wouldn't suggest it's the largest problem that we face, but it'll make it somewhat more difficult. But I mean, fundamentally, at the end of the day, maybe I'll just give you one example. Perhaps once a week we receive, the SDUC that is, receives a call from a former union member who believed that they were still a union member, who phoned up their union and found out that they haven't paid their dues for 9 months. And one of the reasons that that will have happened is because they'll have made a direct debit mistake. Now, in some cases, unions will be in a position to say, listen, we'll represent you anyway, but there's a bit of a union rule that you'll probably understand, that you can't just let people not pay their union dues and still represent them. The payroll means that that doesn't happen. Payroll deductions mean that that doesn't happen ever. And I think that if union members want to avail themselves of that security, then that's the most important thing about check-off.
Linda Fabiani.
I've got a very quick clarification point on check-off, convener, before I move on. And it's just, I think probably Dave can answer this best. I do have a memory of HMRC and the government trying to stop check-off for the employees through PCS of HMRC. And I wondered what happened with that.
HMRC and what essentially happened was when the former Westminster government, the coalition government, tried to move the banning of check-off for the whole of the civil service, they provided any Liberal Democrat-led department and all devolved departments were essentially given the choice. Mr. Swinney was given the choice, and Mr. Swinney understandably mm-hmm. took the choice that he wasn't going to ban check-off. So in certain UK government departments at that time, check-off was banned, including HMRC, but in others it wasn't. What we're now seeing, of course, is the end game to that, yeah. Which is that check-off being banned for all civil service departments.
Yeah, so they already trialled it, and now they're trying to expand
yeah,
it.
Yeah, they ran wherever it was assented to by the Leeds Cabinet Office or relevant minister. It's already happened, and that and the rest is still to come.
Okay, thanks for that. Yeah, and I'd like to go on to picking up from where Alison left off. I guess the devolution and respect agenda about the regulatory powers. We know that the bill originally stated that secretaries of state should be given the responsibility to make the regulations on these issues that affect us. And then it was changed and now states a minister of the Crown will be enabled to make changes to regulations about facility time and check-off in the organisations we've been talking about in the public sector in Scotland. It doesn't seem very clear to me or to many of us whether this is actually referring to a UK minister or a Scottish minister. I know, Dave, you raised it earlier on in these discussions about your perception at the meetings that you've had. I wonder if you could expand on that now.
Well, I will make sure that the committee has access to the response from Nick Bowles to Chris Stevens, MP, where he appears to make this clear that whilst, in a sense, the civil service is an unusual case in point, because the civil service continues to be a UK government department. But it's quite clear from us in our interpretation of what Nick Bowles said that, and just so people are clear, there's two parts to the facility time provisions within the bill. Firstly, that all public sector employers should be required to account for their and give account of their current facility time, and then an optional power of intervention for ministers of the Crown to cap that facility time. So I know your question, Linda, is where is that power going to be vested? Now, everything that we've seen so far, and I say referring back to that letter, suggests that it will be in the relevant UK department, even where that power is. Even where the department has a devolved mirror in Scotland. So we can't come to any other conclusion that the Minister for Health for Westminster will be dictating whether the facility time in the NHS in Scotland should be capped on.
Can I ask for each of your views on the workability of that and how you feel that would affect relationships within Scotland, within your own organisations?
I think I made reference earlier on to what one might plan for by way of steady state and what might actually present itself on a daily basis. We have an enormous change agenda. We discuss with our staff side very, very frequently, both at national level and at board level, what those arrangements may look like in the future, and we engage with staff side on a regular basis, either through our partnership working arrangements or on bilateral discussions. I think it would be very difficult for us to prescribe how often we were going to do that and seek that kind of cap. I think it also becomes worrying when the quantification of that could be viewed as simply a cost, and that boards may then be in a position where they are required to justify why they are spending X amount in terms of facility time without us having the opportunity to influence that discussion with the kind of mature industrial relations stuff that I've been talking about this morning, really.
Yeah, I'm just interested as well in the views of those giving us evidence as to the difficulties that there may well be when you are responsible to devolved ministers, devolved cabinet secretaries, and indeed the Scottish Parliament in many ways, but that regulations can be handed down over functions that are the responsibility of the institutions here. Regulations can be handed down by a UK government of whatever ideology.
I think it's fair to say that in trying to steer the NHS in Scotland, we are responsible to the Scottish Parliament for the delivery of a health service fit for the people of Scotland. Of course, reflecting, if nothing else, our history, we do that with very close relationships with the Department of Health. But our efforts, I think, over the last several years have been to clarify and simplify.
Thank you.
Our primary point of contact in local government is the Scottish Government. We don't have, if any, many connections with the local government department in Westminster. So certainly from our point of view, that there's been that working established. So how would that affect on the ground? Well, sorry to keep going on about it, but we very much don't want to see the change, and we want to make the decisions within the councils, and rather not have anyone elsewhere making the decisions on how we deal with our colleagues in the trade unions.
I'm bound to speculate that it would be politically interesting were such a diktat to be passed down by, let's say, a UK health minister at the same time as the Scottish Minister for Health was suggesting to the NHS in Scotland that they do something different.
Thank you, convener. Can I just say, I think we need absolute clarity in this. It's a hugely important point from Westminster.
I accept that. I think it's an important point. But given that in the regulation issue, given that the only place that the statutory instrument can be brought forward is in the House of Commons and at the UK Parliament, I think it's pretty clear from that the only people who could promote that would be a UK minister. So we'll get clarification. But I think, from my perspective, I think I'm pretty clear on that. Stuart, and then I want to just come up to some of the things I need to get on the record.
Okay, it's a couple of very, very quick points of clarification, just to make sure my assumption is correct. Given the definition of who would be affected by this, relevant public sector employers, if I give you a very, very quick example, if there's two councils, one council has all its services in-house, and the other council has ALMOs, has arms-length organisations, leisure trusts, etc. Is it the case that Chekhov would be, for example, Chekhov is one example, would be banned in the council who's retained those services in-house, but it wouldn't be banned in, therefore, in the ledger trust, etc., the arm's length organisations?
I'm going to invite Jane O'Donnell in here. That's a technical point. I think you'll probably know more about than I do.
That's fine. Hello. Just for clarity, I think that is potentially the case, and I think we need some clarity around that. Obviously, local authorities do have different decision-making for their different services, and it would be very difficult for us to deal with that when we have colleagues working in an ALIO and in a council and have different arrangements. It's very difficult.
Yes. Potentially was the word there, because the bill is far from clear just now, not just in respect of the facility time and the check-off provisions, but also other aspects of the bill as well. What exactly will be defined as a public sector organisation. It's arguable that the bill will be interpreted to include any organisation which is primarily undertaking publicly funded functions, but it's not clear. So where ALIOs, where a range of even voluntary sector organisations might sit within this isn't yet clear from
the bill. That was my next question. Does that then affect third sector, possibly third sector organisations as well?
It absolutely could do. Because if a third sector organisation is delivering either a key service with reference to certain provisions of the bill, yeah, or a public service with reference to other sections of the bill, it's entirely possible that the final bill and the final instruments might interpret those as public sector organisations.
Okay, thank you. And I apologise, Kavira, but just for clarification, am I right again in assuming that Chekhov again, trade union fees obviously would be banned because through Chekhov would be no longer allowed, but if you were a member of a staff association, that wouldn't be banned.
I would need to check that, actually. I would need to check that.
Thanks, Stuart. A couple of questions from me, just to make sure we get some stuff on the record, because we'll need to try to produce a report sometime next week on the proceedings from today. The UK's government's own regulatory policy committee described the impact assessment supporting bill as not fit for purpose and highlighted a severe lack of evidence to support the legislation. Just for the sake of the record, would you agree that the bill is not fit for purpose?
I'll go for a yes on that one.
Yeah. I certainly agree that there is a lack of evidence.
Okay. In which case, and it's unlikely the UK government will not decide to proceed with this bill, but if in the case that they do decide to proceed to the bill, would you support the proposal that the UK government removes Scotland from the territorial extent of the bill through amendments in the House of Commons at the Lords Committee stage, at report stage? Effectively, removing Scotland from the bill in the later process in the Lords at the report stage. Would you think that would be a good idea?
Yeah, I mean, the SGC's existing position is that employment law, including the regulation of trade unions, should be a devolved issue. So it follows from that that any piece of legislation should be a matter for Scotland. Okay. What that doesn't mean, and I think this is important to point that out, what it doesn't mean is that we are careless of the interests of the broader trade union movement, yeah. Nor would it be the case, in our view, were Scotland to be removed, that it would not feel some of the consequences of bad legislation being passed at Westminster.
Billy, do you want to reflect on that?
I was just going to say that I'd be happy, speaking for local government, that, Scotland was removed from it. Okay. That question.
Shirley, as the biggest employer from the NHS side, if you're in a position to say so, I'm not sure if you are.
I think I'd defer to my colleagues either side for that. What I would be happy to say is that the partnership arrangements which have existed for a long time in the NHS in Scotland would not necessarily be added to by any of the proposals that we've seen.
Okay, and if all that was to fail, do you think it would be appropriate that the Scottish Minister should have conferred on them directly the issues directly related to public services in Scotland, such as local authorities, the NHS, Police Scotland, and other devolved matters, that the regulation issues should be left to Scottish ministers?
Absolutely.
And Shirley agrees with that as well?
As far as I'm concerned, health is a devolved matter.
Okay. Billy?
Government's a devolved matter.
Okay, just for the record purposes, because we'll need to draw this report up. So I'm very grateful, folks, for you coming along today, providing us with such substantial evidence. Thank you very much. We're now moving to private session.